Coming up on TekThing, if you like speed, running a VPN in your router might not be a good idea. Hands-on with QNAP's TS-251A Media NAS, more tools for protecting your privacy online, time backups, and the return of car radiator cooling. All coming up on TekThing. Hey patrons, new build video up at patreon.com/techthing. Thank you so much for your support. Without it, we wouldn't be able to make the show for you each and every week. Join the crew that makes TekThing possible at patreon.com/techthing, and you can see that build video too.
I'm Shannon Morse.
And I'm Patrick Norton.
And this is TekThing, where we have something useful in every single show.
Giant dog piles of goodness in this episode.
You like that? Ta-da!
Oh!
Did you like it?
This
is TekThing!
Totally missed it, to be perfectly honest.
What?
Yeah. I was so fixated on the audience. Your awesome gesturing went over my head. In any case, lot of conversation online, especially for me on Twitter with a bunch of friends of mine in MeetSpace. MeetSpace, that's
MeetSpace.
Where we live in the real world. Around privacy and, you know, Congress's vote last week in VPNs. We should make it clear, your ISP pretty much knows everything you're doing.
Mm-hmm.
They have pretty much forever. The FCC ruling that was struck down last week prevented new consumer privacy protections from being enabled later this year.
Mm-hmm.
And like Shannon also pointed out last week, Google, Facebook, ad networks, your mobile carrier, probably your mom, all track you.
Yep. You are the product.
You are the product. And they all, in bits and pieces, or in the case of some of you on Facebook, large dumps of personal information, they have some profoundly personal information about you.
Mm-hmm.
Most of it, which is used to track you or to serve ads to you, is sort of anonymized or washed. But the reality is they're still trying to create a profile.
Yeah.
So that when a Shannon-like object is using Chrome on the website, they can serve Shannon crack to Shannon that makes her go, I'm going to click on that ad and buy that thing.
Was that sugar you just showed me? I will gladly buy that sugar. Was that a Starbucks Frappuccino ad? I think I want a Starbucks Frappuccino today.
I just feel
like that's
suddenly,
how it works.
Yeah, you know, some of you are more susceptible to it than others.
But. So what are we talking about today?
So we're going to start by saying if you want to keep as much information private or to yourself, mm-hmm. we want to keep as private as possible online, let's start with HTTPS everywhere.
Yeah.
Right? We've talked about this. This basically tells you this extension you add to your browser. It makes sure as often as possible that you are running an encrypted connection to that website. And once that HTTPS connection, it doesn't matter if it's your bank or if it's, you know, www.naughtyvideodownloads.com, nobody can see what you're doing. They can make some pretty good assumptions if you're at naughtyvideodownloads.com, but they won't know exactly what naughty videos you were downloading.
Basically.
step two, you should be running something like Privacy Badger, which, like HTTPS everywhere, is put out by the good crew at the EFF. Privacy Badger, it's really simple. Blocks spying ads and invisible trackers. And if you look in the corner, it's going to tell you what's going on there. We've detected a potential tracker on this page.
Oh, no.
And some trackers, cookies you may like. You know, another option is uBlock Origin.
Mm-hmm.
You can run both if you want to. Privacy Badger is trying to uncover things. uBlock's going to a whitelist. They are both super awesome tools to basically keep. It's not so much the ads, or as the 30, I think the most we've seen once was like 37 different tracking tools enabled on a website. Because I think it was 37, maybe even 31. But
that's
the idea that they had all of this stuff running on the web page, in some cases,
it
like.
It slows the web page down so
yes.
much.
I talked about this a couple months ago. I was like, I give up. I'm going to put an ad blocker on.
Yes.
And all of a sudden, the browser speed just went through the roof.
Mm-hmm.
But also, the amount of information that's being gathered about you if you're running Privacy Badger or uBlock Origin will drop precipitously.
Yeah.
Something we were talking about last week, run a VPN. You could also run the Tor browser. If you are getting full on, like I'm hiding all the things from everyone, like HTTPS, Privacy Badger, uBlock, Tor browser, through a VPN, right? You know, and we say like your VPN is only as good as the people running it.
Yes.
Some of them will be scum.
Yes. Pay attention to that part. Pay attention to that part so much because I think it's the most important part. And also disclaimer, yes, we're aware of exit nodes with Tor browser and the whole government thing. So don't worry, we know.
Yeah, there's. So many things to discuss. So all of that aside, You also need to pay attention to what your settings are in your browser.
Oh, yeah.
In Facebook. In everything else, right? This sounds really stupid, but you know, if you choose to share all of your information on a particular social site, it kind of obviates the hiding yourself you're doing in other places.
Absolutely.
So, you know, be aware of what you make public or available or searchable. You know,
and a lot of times you'll notice social networks will change how they set up their security features and the default securities that they have on their website. So maybe your profile on Facebook was private last year, but part of it became public this year without your knowledge. You want to go back and check that not just once in your lifetime of using Facebook, but again and again and again. And not to single out Facebook, but that is a problem that they've had quite a bit in the past. So one of the things that I will do pretty often, about once a year, once every 6 months, is go through all my social networks and all my online accounts and make sure that all of my privacy settings are still how I want them to be, because I might change my mind as well. I think that's really important to pay attention to, you know, not just what apps you're installing on there, but also what kind of stuff, like he said, that you're doing with your own social network accounts.
If your ISP gives you the option to opt out of certain types of tracking or advertising delivery, then by all means, you should opt out. But remember, the default on the internet is almost never protect my privacy.
Oh, no.
It's almost always, well, if I can dig through these 17 menus and find this three settings here and this obscurely named, you know what I mean? Like, that's what the part that drives me nuts is sometimes do not track my every location and personal thought and make it searchable is hidden under, you know, echolocation of interpersonal. Yeah, you know, like I'm being ridiculous, but there's been times where we've been like, really? That's the that's what you call privacy or keeping information private?
Well, let's talk about VPNs a little bit.
Yes.
You know, you probably have a VPN running on all your different devices in your household, be it your laptop or your gaming PC or your mobile phone or whatever it is, or on your router maybe, but that would slow it down in a pretty big way. So yes, you can run a VPN on a router. Whether the router you currently own can actually connect to your home through a VPN, that's a different question in itself, and that's something that a lot of people are concerned about right now.
So yeah, we were talking about that last week. Like most routers don't do VPN. Mm-hmm. Most routers that are set up to do VPN into your home network from a remote location, i.e. from your laptop when you travel, tunneling and encrypting your traffic to get to
back to your home network.
Right, so, you know, and keeping it safe from whatever nefarious hackers are browsing the Wi-Fi's in the hotel. You know, there's a ton of routers out there that do that, some better than others. What's been interesting, you know, if you get into something like Hide My Ass, they have a wonderful guide of routers that will actually work with VPNs, right? And one I'm going to test hopefully next week, the Linksys WRT32ACM, because it has a very, very powerful processor.
Cool.
Generally speaking, if your router can run DDWRT, Tomato, or PFSense, they can all connect to my VPN, for example, private internet access. They can tunnel all of your home traffic through a VPN. Mm-hmm. So what that looks like is kind of peculiar.
Peculiar?
Well, okay, so if you don't have an extremely powerful router, and maybe if you do, the overhead to the VPN encryption is going to slow things down.
Right.
And it's been interesting to look at that. So if we pull up my laptop right here, this is the software for a Synology RT2600AC. I downloaded the VPN Plus server, which is actually to set up tunneling into the router.
Oh, okay.
But if you want to connect the router to a VPN, you go into the network center, you go to internet, and you go into VPN settings. In a lot of cases, there's an OpenVPN config file you can download. That wouldn't actually connect for me. I ended up having to go into a manual configuration.
Oh, okay.
And if I hit edit on here, and hopefully this is grayed out. If not,
I will gray that out for you in editing.
You know, so I had to pick a server address, right? So let's take a look. Here we go. So the server address, right, you know, depending on what country you want to tunnel into or are tunneling in from, that would be, you know, the URL for where you want to dig into.
Cool.
You're also going to need to verify that your settings are correct. And this one can be interesting because you'll notice these 2048 and 4096 certs. It'd be interesting to see if I can try the basic ca.crt file to see if that's any faster, because I'll tell you, the 2048 cert was criminally slow. And you're also going to want to reconfigure the DNS, because in many router, in the case of many routers, mm-hmm. once you connect the router to a VPN, the DNS configuration is cut off unless you manually configure it.
Yeah.
Which is really interesting when you like turn on the VPN and all of a sudden the internet stops working.
No.
Which is what she said.
That's what you don't want to happen.
Yeah. And oh, by the way, you're also going to need to make sure you download the certificate to work with the encryption for your VPN.
Mm-hmm.
So you got it, right? then once all that's done, you can go in and you can select it and you can hit connect.
Okay.
And then it
should transfer all of your devices' data through the VPN.
Exactly.
Okay. Cool.
So you're protected. But in the case of the configuration I was able to set up for this, things slowed down.
Yeah.
Let me give you a wonder. This is a graph, ladies and gentlemen. Normally, we have
an 11. Did you make that graph?
I made that graph.
That's beautiful.
With like a kindergartner's graph making software.
That's really good.
So you'll notice one of those columns is much bigger than the other. Normally, with a VPN off, you've got like an 11 millisecond ping and 123 megabits per second down and 12 megabits per second up. With a VPN turned on, i.e. with your traffic encrypted on the router, mm-hmm. we got a 28 millisecond ping time, 21 megabits per second down. So this one is a lot smaller than this one.
Yeah.
And 11.3 megabits per second up. So
that's a huge difference.
Yeah, upload speeds. Now that was a synthetic like speed test. In terms of like downloading files, for example, download the same file, the same network. Mm-hmm. I kind of tested it back and forth.
Didn't
three or
change
four times.
Anything other than turning on the VPN.
Yeah.
Okay.
Three or four different times, literally. The download went from 3 minutes without a VPN,
okay.
13 to 14 megabits per, or megabytes per second, to 45 minutes to an hour,
what?
With 700 to 1,000 kilobytes per second.
Ouch.
So yeah, like it went from like 3 minutes to like 45
That's
minutes.
That's like living
plus.
In the 90s.
Yes.
Dial up.
on top of that, configuring VPN on the router can create problems. I had some wonderful responses. Thanks to everybody
yes.
who tweeted back at Patrick Norton on Twitter. For example, Netflix. Although my VPN was not, Netflix was not upset by my exit node for my VPN.
Okay.
Steam games.
Yeah.
People have had problems with Netflix with Steam shopping at Target.
What?
Yeah. Crazy. But think about it. If you are a major retailer and you're worried about credit card fraud,
true.
How many Target shoppers normally connect to Target through
they might flag
a VPN?
It. Yep.
Exactly. So, yeah, yesterday I was happily running Netflix and Steam while inside a VPN connection. Tomorrow it may not work because those VPN IP addresses may be flagged.
Yeah.
So this is a long way with speedy evidence, and who knows, maybe I can figure out how to dial the encryption down on that connection and make it run faster, but running VPN at the router might not be the best way to go. So look at the VPN options we talked about in the past, make sure you have Privacy Badger.
Oh. Also, we did a segment on Hack 5. I know some of you guys at home are watchers of Hack 5 and TekThing, and you probably own Wi-Fi Pineapples. And we did do a segment last year. I think it was a three-parter. Mm-hmm. I don't know, just Google like Hack 5 VPN, or I'll put the link in the show notes.
Right.
But we talked about putting a VPN on there, buying a VPS server so you could distribute all of your data through mm-hmm. that Wi-Fi Pineapple. But again, you run into the same problem where the VPN slows down your traffic exponentially to the point where sometimes it's not bearable depending on what you're trying to do on the net. So it's kind of a win and lose situation that you have there. Do you want to pay a provider to stick a VPN on all of your devices like private internet access does, or do you want to put all of your data through your router on a VPN and then have to deal with the Netflix complications and stuff like that? So
well, and it may it who knows, right? Because the other thing is, a number of people I have sort of read up on or consulted, they're like, don't worry about 256 AES, 120 AES is fine because like it's just a VPN connection.
Yeah.
It's not like you're trying to protect your tax data for 50 years. but you can also play, in some cases, you can actually play around in the settings. I'm not seeing it in here, but in some cases you can configure the settings to
you can yes
to lower the level of there it is you know, if you just clicked on encryption.
Yeah.
Yeah, for example, this one, part of the reason why this runs so fast is it's AES 128 versus AES 256. And you notice they don't actually offer, and you'll notice they don't actually offer anything higher than that. But it is something to consider. I've had great luck in terms of an individual computer mm-hmm. with a connection to a commercial VPN.
Yeah, me too.
I am not so impressed with routers connecting to VPN, but I'm going to try a faster router. And if anybody out there is running pfSense or something else on a super powerful box, let us know. We would be very, very delighted to hear from it.
Oh, yes, please.
The other thing I was laughing about that came out last week, great article on Ars Technica, several other places. Comcast, we won't sell browser history, and you can opt out of targeted ads.
Ha ha ha! Really?
No, actually, it was a big deal for like every.
Well, really?
Yeah, AT&T, you know, basically, you know, they're like stoked.
They're all freaking out because everybody's installing VPNs.
Yeah, well, we'll find out. Verizon also posted a blog about its privacy policy. One of the nice things about this, and we'll put the link to this in the show notes, Cox goes one step further saying, quote, it does not collect the individual web browsing history of our customers and has no plans to.
Okay.
It's interesting to say all of these companies are all like, you know, it's nice to actually have for once all of the information linked to in one place.
That is nice.
My question is,
skeptical,
will
though.
Any of this still apply in 6 months or 12 months?
Yeah.
Because
policies get updated all the time.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Usually 50 pages down or 1,000 words into legalese. Just saying. All the ISPs this week say they love your privacy.
Let us know what you're doing about your security and privacy online with all the new information that's coming out of Congress these past couple of weeks. We would love to know. Email us, ask@techthing.com, or you can tweet us @techthing.
Got an email from Courtney who writes in, I'm interested in a NAS, looking for at least 3 bays. Right now, I'm focused on the QNAP TS-451. Would you recommend anything different? Thanks, Courtney in North Carolina.
North Carolina.
Yeah. Oh, my goodness.
Well, all right.
What's kind of funny is you have the QNAP TS-251A.
Yes. But that one has 2 bays, not 4.
And some media features.
Yeah, and it has media features. That's why it has the A in the name. But it's pretty comparable to the 451 as far as like what kind of firmware you're going to use, because they come from the same company.
Yeah, I mean, the biggest difference between the TS-451 and the TS-251 that you're asking about is support for RAID 5, 6, and 10. You know, on the 251, you can choose RAID 0 or RAID 1 to mirror the drives. Go with RAID 1.
Go with RAID 1, yes.
RAID 0 is death RAID. Faster, but if one drive goes, you lose all your data. But yeah, it was crazy. I was looking at this, and I was like, they're almost exactly the same, the 4 drive and the 2 drive versions. You really like the interface on the QNAP.
Yes. So today, I am checking out the TS-251A. Basically, over on Amazon, you're going to find this for around $300. Right now, it's $308.99 with only 10 left. So get one if you're actually interested in it. This one comes with an Intel Celeron N3060 dual-core 1.6 gigahertz CPU, 2 gigs of DDR3 RAM, 2 gigabit Ethernet LAN ports on the back, and then it also has USB quick access on the front, 2 USB 3.0 ports on the back as well, and there's also, and this is weird for a NAS, it comes with HDMI mic and headphone jacks, which is so interesting. Yeah, more on that later. And then it also accepts 2.5 or 3.5 inch drives. I have 2 3.5 inch, 2 terabyte Western Digital Reds in here, I believe. Interestingly enough, they were the same hard drives that I used to review the last QNAP, so I had to remember my username and password, and I was just like, I don't remember what I used, so I had to reset it. That was a good time. It is plasticky. You're going to notice that whenever you're using it, but it is well built, so it doesn't feel like, you know, it's going to fall apart if you drop it or something. There is micro B on the front for hooking up an external drive as well. So if for some reason you want to plug in an external drive real quick and copy over your data, you can do that without having to use a computer in between the two. And there's an SD card slot as well, so you can just stick it in from your camera, for example, and then copy over your photos. Kind of cool that they included those features, because you don't see those on a lot of NASs. So this thing's got a really easy setup. I will show you what the actual firmware on here looks like, the web interface. So luckily, it's really easy to set up via a direct connection over USB to your computer or over the network. You will want to download this thing called QNAP QFinder Pro. This immediately found it via my network, so it was really easy to set up, and I can just double click on it, and then it shows up in my web GUI, and I'm able to log in with my username and password. It does set up a default IP address via DHCP, and then the username and password are defaulted to like admin, unless you want to change it. So.
Change it.
Yeah, I highly suggest that you change it if you have not already. It's a very good idea. The web interface is really lovely. It looks a lot like an Apple device. Mm-hmm. I know I'm not one to always say Apple devices are lovely, but this looks really nice, and it's very easy to use. There's app menus in the web GUI, just like you would find on a Synology router, for example. So their interfaces are very comparable. So you have all your nice little icons here. You have an app center if you want to click into that, and you can load up different apps in here depending on what you're looking for.
Music station.
Lots of customization,
too. Photo station.
Yeah, tons and tons of different options. So if you go into your settings here, you will find tons of customizations available. I kept most of mine on default just for the review, but you can do plenty of things like automatic updating. You can do automatic backups. You can change the hardware platform. You can change it to RAID. Do pretty much whatever you want. QFinder Pro software, again, is very easy. You can access your files over USB, which is very uncommon for a NAS. So for example, if I wanted to, I could just load this up and drop over a media upload of any kind of files that I wanted to straight from my computer very simply, or I could just plug it in over USB via this interface on the front and load up things straight through there without the need for a network.
It's nice to transfer things faster.
Yeah, it is, exactly. So that's really nice that they have that available. Transcoding video via the web GUI worked really great for 1080p HD videos, but it did choke whenever I was running a 4K test of footage while I was playing over my gigabit network. So nothing in between the two other than just the network. But it did choke a little bit on that kind of footage. Mm-hmm. Now, if I played it straight through VLC, through the Windows Network Share, which you can just pull up through your File Explorer, VLC played the 4K test footage fine, and that was over the network as well. So it just seemed to be the web interface that choked on the video files and not just through your regular Windows GUI. So that was kind of an interesting little hiccup that I found while I was messing with this. File transfers, those were super fast. I was able to get about 116 megabytes per second.
Nice.
I think it's bytes, right?
Bytes. Capital M, capital B, bytes.
Bytes. I always get them backwards. That was for a 500 megabyte video file, and then photos and music copied over in about 58 megabytes per second. So extremely fast, like blink of an eye for the photos and the music. The videos, of course, I had to wait a little bit longer for a 500 meg video, but it was very fast. So using it as a media share, this is the cool thing that I wanted to talk about via the HDMI. You can connect it directly to a TV, and you can watch videos or view photos and use the supplied remote control, which is also included right here. It's basically like a really pretty and easy to use home theater PC is what I was thinking of whenever I was messing with it.
It won't do Netflix, it won't do Amazon
Prime.
It won't,
yeah. It does have Plex. If you have a Plex account and you want to set up Plex, you can do that. But if you just want to use it to browse like your photos and videos, you can totally just connect it to a monitor and like use the remote to get around into your files. You can go home and then choose different directories through the remote, which I thought was really neat. I also love that you can simply connect it to your Chromecast or a Roku or a Fire TV or an Apple TV and play your data that way as well. Very, very cool that they included that too.
Nice.
That's as easy as going over to the web interface and opening up one of the apps. For example, I will go over to, I think it's set up in here. So when you pull up your photo station, you can just click on the little Chromecast button right here and choose whatever is linked to it. So this was kind of unexpected, but I could also stream music from the music station over to my Sonos setup, which I, for some reason, I didn't know that was possible, but I was like, oh, cool, it recognizes that I have Sonos on my network, how neat. So that was just automatic. I didn't have to do any setup for that, except for make sure that it could see everything that's on the network. Wow, easy. So everything for streaming is controlled via the web interface.
No, I'm laughing because it's like, I've had people be like, wait, I can stream my audio files to the Sonos? Like, yeah, you just have to
yeah,
connect the thing to the thing.
Like, I'm just so used to having to install and use the Sonos app, but you don't have to. Of course you don't. Plex, again, that's also available for multimedia use if you want to. I don't have Plex installed, so I didn't use it.
Does it have can I back up my computer to it and do sort of old school NAS things?
Totally. Other regular NAS things are totally built in, automatic backupping, file sharing across multiple devices. There's a surveillance station if you want to use that too and set up a surveillance camera in your household. Awesome, awesome, awesome. I was really, really enjoying playing with this NAS, testing out the various entertainment options. I think it would be a really great option for NAS if you want something to play music, photos, and videos off of. I think it is a little bit pricey to just use as a backup server, though, so keep that in mind if you're looking for something on the web to use as a NAS box specifically for backups or specifically for entertainment.
I was gonna say, I think the regular QNAP TS-251, which of course I can't find because they have so many options.
It's good they have options.
Yeah, it's 50, oh, it's yeah. 50, 60 bucks less.
Okay, cool.
If you don't want the IR remote and the hardware encryption tool.
All the fancy remote stuff. But I really like the entertainment option because I haven't built a home theater PC in forever. And I was just like, I could just plug this in and use it. I know, right? I need to get on the Plex train. I need to get on that bandwagon. Let us know what you think of NAS boxes and if there's any in particular that you want us to review. I really enjoyed playing with this one, so I would love to see other similar ones to compare them as well. You can email us over at askattechthing.com or you can send me a tweet personally. I'm at Snubs, your NAS girl.
NAS girl. Shannon just asked you about more NASs to review. If you got a question for us, a tech question or something you want to see reviewed, fire it out, askattechthing.com, please. Or you can tweet at TekThing, at Snubs, or at Patrick Norton. And hey, if you want to be part of the crew that makes TekThing possible, please contribute to the show at patreon.com/TekThing. Just a dollar an episode will make a big difference for us. And we just posted our Ryzen 7 build video. Patrons get access to an audio-only feed along with those build videos and quite a bit more. Thank you for your patronage. You make this show possible. And hey, thank you everyone watching. Thank you for supporting the show, no matter how you do it.
We got an email from Debra who writes, Patrick and Shannon was revisiting TekThing 108 on choosing a VPN from January in light of the recent moves by Congress. In reviewing the settings of my VPN client, I was wondering how to tell if DNS leaking is a problem. And if it is a problem, what do I do about it? The VPN supports an option to combat this, but they issue a warning. Quote, only set this parameter if you really need to. Do I really need to? Keep up the great work. Debra B. in Greater Cincinnati. Thank you, Debra.
Oh my goodness.
Oh boy, DNS leaking.
Okay, so sorry, I'm flashing back to, I think it was Jungle Jim's, this crazy supermarket in Cincinnati. Oh. Long story. Or
I've never been.
In the greater Cincinnati area. So DNS, domain name server, that's what converts www.techthing.com into like 198.49.23.144 or 198.185.159.144, or I could go on, but it put us all to sleep. DNS leak is when your operating system uses the default DNS servers assigned by, say, your ISP instead of ones through your VPN. So it means your DNS requests aren't routed through the VPN or the anonymous DNS servers that should be assigned to you by your VPN server. So tracking DNS, a way to know where folks are pointing their browsers.
Ah, I see. Yeah. That can be scary.
That can be nefarious.
Yes.
Or weird. Simple way to check this is to go to dnsleaktest.com with your VPN off. And in my case, it looks something a lot like this. That's I use Google because I was trying to avoid some irritations with my ISP. I've been using Google, and look, for the DNS results, we get a whole bunch of Google stuff here. So. Once you've done that, turn on your VPN and then do the same DNS leak test. So we go from this to bing.
Oh, yeah. Cool.
Mine looked fine, as in very different from the one that shows up when the VPN is turned off.
Okay.
If yours look the same, you might consider turning on the special DNS leak protection in your case, actually, private internet access. Though, hey, that is on by default in OS X.
That's nice.
The paranoia that they're bringing to the Windows turning that on is because they have to modify the operating system's network settings, which, quote, can in rare cases cause connectivity issues.
Okay.
I think it's more of an issue if you have a particular corporate configuration going through a proxy server or something.
Might run into some connectivity issues there. But if it's on your home network, it should be fine. Just turn it on and see if you lose connection.
What's the worst you can...
What's the worst that can happen?
Just back up first. What's the worst that can happen? You completely reinstall Windows. The computer eats your face. Your cat dies.
I'm making such a light info about it. Oh, what's the worst that could happen?
Have you backed up? 3, 2, 1. 3 copies, 2 different mediums, at least 1 off-site. We haven't said that in, I don't know, a couple episodes. It's always good to remind you to back up.
Yes.
Bill's got some thoughts on using the Raspberry Pi for backing up. He wrote askatechthing.com, Patrick and Snubs, I use my Raspberry Pi 2 NAS as a backup only, and it works quite well. I have 2 2-terabytes, a 4-terabyte, and 2 5-terabyte drives connected via a USB hub as JBOD. I use SyncToy to back up my data. Just in case you wonder why so much storage, most of the data is video files. One of the 5-terabyte drives is nearly full of movies recorded from the TCM channel. Mm-hmm. Bill in Huntsville, Alabama.
Thank you, Bill.
JBOD, one of my favorite phrases, just a bunch of disks.
JBOD. And,
since it's like tangent day for me, something it is definitely not. Well, first of all, SyncToy, I haven't used in forever. I think the last version you can download is from 2009, but it still works. And if you want to have a lot of fun with just a bunch of disks, go to stablebit.com/drivepool. And it's a really cool disk pooling application that duplicates files. So if you lose a drive, you don't have a catastrophic loss of data.
Oh, no way. Cool.
Malvin Tonnell over at PC Per had like 14 drives connected to this sitting on the ground next to his desk. Or maybe it was in a drawer next to his desk. I'm sure he'll email me if I got it wrong. Really cool application.
That's awesome.
Costs like $30 and you can try it for free for 30 days.
One time $30?
One time.
Perfect.
Oh, man.
Cool. Thank you for that. And we...
Go ahead.
Where are you going?
You should read the thing.
Okay. Sirpia also posted on patreon.com/techthing. Patrick, the fan question. With fans that big, why didn't you use the car radiator cooler? I see where he was going with this. Yeah.
I should point out it's 2 140 millimeter fans on the H110i GT liquid cooler from Corsair. I think I tried to claim it was like 2 240 millimeter fans. So dual 140 millimeter fans and a 200 millimeter radiator.
Okay.
And I gotta say, one of the reasons I didn't hook it up is because, well, here. You can hold on to the plumbing for a second while I get down. This is a radiator I got, I think, out of a Dodge minivan for a crazy liquid cooling build 1,000 years ago. And there's the pump and the cooling plate.
It's so dusty.
It's been sitting around for a while waiting for a new life. But this is what the car radiator looks like. It is a really effective cooler.
Yes, it is.
This is what the 2 140 millimeter fans look like in front of it.
Wow.
I'm just saying one of these things is a lot bigger than the other.
Yes, yes.
The other reason I didn't use this, as much as I love ridiculous excessive cooling, is because I would have had to have fabricated an AMD mount for the cooling plate.
Yeah, you would have.
And I would have had to run all new cooling.
Right.
Tubing, because this cooling tubing is getting a little old. And look, there's still some liquid coming out of that. And liquid coming out of a cooling system that is not sealed can cause the magic smoke to come out of your motherboard and never work again. Sealed coolers like that H110i GT make it much, much harder to have an oops and kill your motherboard. A drop of water in the wrong place will fry it.
Yeah, so true.
That is why I went with the somewhat large fans compared
to the... Just buy the thing. Don't mod it yourself in that case.
If you want to mod it yourself, go for it. Sometimes I just look around and go, I got to fix the windows on the house.
Oh, man. And we also got a pick for our analog pick of the week. Once in a while, put down your phone, step away from the screen, close the laptop, and do something analog like Moses, who writes about the Polynesia Cultural Center located over in Hawaii. He says, it is awesome. You basically enter replica villages of the different tribes and people who lived on Hawaii and the other islands located near Hawaii. It is the most beautiful and most educational museum I have ever visited. And you can check out the website over at polynesia.com from Moses. I love this. I was checking it out. I got to go to Tahiti for my honeymoon, and they have a village experience about Tahiti. So I would love to see some more information about the history of that place because it was amazing and gorgeous and I loved it.
42 acres.
This is cool. My sister just moved to Hawaii, so I'm gonna make her go here with me. She doesn't know it yet, but it's happening. Look, you can ride in a boat. Yes. That sounds awesome.
How long have been since you've been sailing?
I've never been sailing.
We gotta fix that.
I know.
Ladies and gentlemen, I'm Patrick Norton.
I'm Shannon Morse.
We'll see you next week on TekThing. Sailing on the bay?
I've never been sailing on the bay. How is
like
that?
10 years,
I know.
Years,
I have
years?
Been here for 6 years
in
the San Francisco Bay Area, and I've never been sailing on the bay. Can
we
you
gotta
believe
fix that.
It? We do. Jason has some friends that go sailing. They call it beer boat cruising or something because they bring beers.
No, well, it's the beer can races.
Beer
it's,
can races.
Yeah.
Yes.
The basically those
has
are
something
the,
to do with beers.
The informal races that take place to tune up your crew for the serious racing.
Yeah,
on the weekend.
I'd be down with that. That sounds really fun.
The trick is to be on the right boat. What you want to be is on a good boat that has fun people, not on a boat where they're like, we're going to shave a 15th of a second off this uphill wedge. You didn't pull that rope fast enough.
Sorry.
Swim home.
What do I do?
you'll be railed. That means you hang over the side of the boat and help counter the impact of the wind on the sail.
No way, man.
There's a big...
Can I just sit
it's
in
like
the middle
leaning
and
the
like...
Fence.
Use my phone and be like, look what we're doing.
If you find the right boat, you can just sit back there with a Mai Tai and make, you know, comments.
That's what I want to do.
Yeah. The trick is not get thrown off the boat.